And finally this morning, Michael Jackson has been something of a rock and roll recluse lately, but that ended yesterday with a surprise visit to Disney World in Florida. Jackson arrived with Macaulay Culkin, the young star of the movie Home Alone. Jackson posed with fans and told reporters he was there to relax. He came to Disney World after spending a week in Bermuda with Culkin's family. They plan to spend at least one more day at the park. And that's the news at 8 minutes after the hour. Mark's in for Harry this week, as you know.
While Michael Jackson took to the stage in Bangkok today, back at home, his status as a pop icon is taking a beating. Rumors swirled around Hollywood after two of Jackson's homes were searched over the weekend by Los Angeles police. Police sources confirm allegations of child abuse are being investigated.
It's very important that we're very careful on how we proceed in the investigation.
Jackson's private investigator says the allegations followed a blackmail attempt.
Many people try to extort Michael because of who he is and, you know, the amount of money he has, and these people wanted $20 million.
The man who hobnobs with presidents and keeps company with Hollywood's elite today denied the allegations through his attorney.
There was no wrongdoing on my part.
The irony in all of this is that Michael Jackson has been known for his kindness toward children. He discussed this in his February ABC interview with Oprah Winfrey.
We'll have like 100 bald-headed children here who they all have cancer. And they're running around and they're enjoying themselves, and it just makes me cry happy tears that I was able to do that for them.
And that's why this allegation is even more preposterous and also even more hurtful to Michael and his family, which is really, you know, dysfunctional enough, you know, I mean.
So silly, it's sickening.
In the ranch community where Jackson lives, his fans are standing by him.
He's a quiet, gentle person that's just trying to do some good in the world.
The LAPD refuses to disclose details of the search warrant, so just what they were looking for in Jackson's homes remains as mysterious tonight as the superstar himself. Sandra Hughes, CBS News, Los Angeles.
Another story still unfolding in Los Angeles tonight. New details are emerging about the police investigation of pop star Michael Jackson for alleged child abuse. Correspondent Sandra Hughes has been trying to separate the facts from the rumors.
Not a very popular name at the moment, is it? Michael Jackson.
They were harpooning a superstar on the radio, in print, and on television. The talk on talk radio was speculation about an investigation into sexual abuse charges by a 13-year-old boy against pop icon Michael Jackson.
I hope he isn't going to be tarred and feathered before there's any real proof of anything.
Los Angeles police sources admit the sexually exploited child unit is investigating and that two of Michael Jackson's homes were searched over the weekend. It's reported videotapes and photographs were seized. In this August 17th court document, in a custody battle over the alleged victim, his father petitioned his mother not to allow the minor child to have any contact or communication with a third-party adult male known as Michael Jackson.
The 13-year-old boy involved in the custody case is said to have been friends with Jackson, traveling to Monaco with the superstar. The boy reportedly told his therapist about the alleged abuse, and therapists are required by law to turn that kind of information over to police.
The boy's father is a Beverly Hills dentist who co-wrote the screenplay for the recent Mel Brooks comedy Robin Hood Men in Tights. Experts caution that accusations of child abuse are often a weapon used in custody cases.
That is because there seems to be no limit in what one partner will do to another because they are angry and because they want to hurt the other parent and because they don't want to give up the child.
Jackson denies the abuse. Meanwhile, he's postponed tonight's Bangkok concert. His doctor says he's suffering from dehydration. Sandra Hughes, CBS News, Los Angeles.
Now it's time to bring you up to date on the latest news this morning. Controversy is swirling about Michael Jackson this morning as details of a criminal investigation are revealed. Sandra Hughes reports on the police probe and Jackson's response.
Michael Jackson's dangerous tour continued without a hitch to sold-out crowds in Bangkok. But back at home, his image was at risk. That's because of reports of allegations by a 13-year-old boy accusing Jackson of fondling him. Through his newly hired criminal lawyer, Jackson denied the accusation.
There was no wrongdoing on my part.
The reports say the boy, the son of a Beverly Hills dentist, told his therapist about the alleged incident. The attorney for the boy's mother called CNN to say the mother was unaware of the accusation.
She is shocked by it as anybody else is. If it is true, she is certainly upset about it, to say the least. Enraged would probably be another adjective that would describe her feeling.
Los Angeles police are being tight-lipped about their investigation. They won't reveal any details of the two searches made on Jackson's California homes over the weekend. But Jackson's private investigator says the claims are just a backlash from a failed blackmail attempt.
This extortion attempt didn't work. You know, we won't kowtow to that. There's been many, many people who try to extort Michael because of who he is and, you know, the amount of money he has.
Pelicano says the extortionist wanted $20 million, but Jackson wouldn't give in. The singer, although somewhat reclusive, has been praised for his kindness toward children. Near Santa Ynez, where Jackson makes his home, fans are standing by their idol.
I just wish people would just leave him alone. He's a quiet, gentle person that's just trying to do some good in the world.
Just what police were looking for inside Jackson's homes is contained in the search warrants, which police aren't making public. But there are reports that videotapes and photographs were seized in the search. Sandra Hughes, CBS News, Los Angeles.
We'll have more on the Michael Jackson story coming up right after the news this
morning. No matter how hard the times may seem, don't give up our plans, don't give up our dreams. Broken bridges can turn us around, 'cause what we're searching for,
yeah, yo, yo, yo. Hey yo, listen here, Shortcake, can they glow? You know we both make angels when we lay in the snow. Heat the house with the oven when the chips got low, 'cause Tony can't be out there pushing that blow. We made plans and dreams, not grands and schemes. I wanna search for the meaning of love, see what it means. 'Cause we hustled so hard, crossed so many bridges, made babies, took trips to the mall for family pictures. And our souls is magnetic, we the meaning of destiny. Be that bank of trust that looks to invest in me. Together to get her means for me to get you. We back, reunite like the woo, see we soulmates, we melt like cookies and cream. And I fiend for the days and the nights to sex my queen. So no matter how hard it seems, dreams come true. Keep a law on our hearts, hugs and kisses, Tony Stark.
No matter how hard the times may seem, don't give up our plans, don't give up our dreams. No broken bridges can turn us around, 'cause what we're searching for,
yeah, still applying the pain, the purple fire in my brain, this woman crying again. She tired of fighting, my feelings likely the same. That's what happens when you're wife and they try and tighten the chain. See, she in the right, so I put her right in the lane. I'm all night with the pipe, I can feel her biting my chain. She got her own, I ain't gotta buy her a thing. I be burning up the sheets every time I'm lighting the chain. We go together live, Martin and Gina Bud. She get up tight on the thigh, like I can clean her soap. Love her or leave her alone, like I don't need her though. A minute later, I'm back, like I ain't mean it, yo. We break up just to make up. She flowered out the makeup. Together we upgrade to 8+. So all this bickering ain't us. We bigger than that. You only cool when I'm digging your back, and I fall back.
No matter how hard the times may seem, don't give up our plans, don't give up our dreams. No broken bridges can turn us around, 'cause what we're searching for,
shorty with the flavor like Briar's, real sweet with your thick legs. Look like you drink eggs, you lying. Now you met a Teflon Don. Stay high, Levi's on. YSL frames, no games. I'm in the cashing in, getting this paper, buying up acres. Ride around in your with my neighbors. Pocket full of hunnids and weeds. Light the Philly cigar up and go dolo. Ride through Soho. You hear the little baby in the back? That's the sound of sweet life. A sweet whiz will make you a sweet night. Chill with the pawns you want, 'cause life is a chessboard. You better have your soul. Invest on. Never hate your enemies, 'cause it affects judgment. They only hate it if they know you getting hella cheese. That's what it is, what it do for you. Don't let the truth bore you. Word up, don't let the youth spoil you.
No matter how hard the times may seem, don't give up our plans, don't give up our dreams. No broken bridges can turn us around.
Segment one this morning, the latest in the Michael Jackson story. This morning, Jackson canceled another concert in Bangkok while in the U.S. authorities expanded their investigation of child abuse charges. We want to get you the story now from both datelines. CBS reporter Rick Fredrickson joins us on the phone from Bangkok, and joining us from L.A., investigative reporter Harvey Levin, who is following the story for KCBS-TV. Good morning to both of you. Thank you very much for joining us.
Good morning.
Rick, it is being reported here that Michael Jackson was treated for dehydration yesterday. What is being reported there?
Well, that's still the same problem, dehydration. And they say it stems from his song and dance show that opened up this concert series in Bangkok on Tuesday. Apparently, it's happened before. You combine the hot stage lights of the stadium and the humidity from the monsoon season here, and Jackson apparently just wilted. One promoter likens it to doing 2 hours of aerobics in a steam bath. Apparently, he's not in any danger. He's just too weak to do the kind of all-out production that he's used to doing and people want to see. In fact, it's actually on doctor's orders that he's taking this second day off.
Well, there has been speculation that there is more to this than just a dehydration problem. There were reports yesterday of a suicide attempt. What light could you shed on any of those reports?
Yeah, as you can imagine, Paula, the rumor mill is thriving in this kind of atmosphere, but so far none has been confirmed, at least on this end. The star's publicist today rejected a whole list of rumors. And all of the officials and the circumstantial evidence that we talk to and we look at point to dehydration during that first concert. People backstage said that that they saw Jackson gulping oxygen. The hotel staff said he looked horrible when he arrived back at his room. And the doctor for the tour group and the promoters, they all back up this medical consensus. So I suppose there is some logical speculation that the stress from all of the developments back home may have helped to contribute to a slower recuperation.
How are the fans there reacting to the news of allegations of sexual abuse?
Well, you know, I think they made a mistake. One thing yesterday, they canceled the concert just a little bit too late. So you have a stadium full of people filling up the stadium. They had taken the day off. They'd come through Bangkok's gridlock traffic, and there were some boos. But the Thais are a patient people, and they respect Michael Jackson, I believe, for his talent. And at least at this point, they prefer to basically ignore the investigation. And in fact, Jackson today addressed his fans in an audio tape that was played at a press conference. He apologized to them, and he promised that he'll be there to see them tomorrow, and closed with an I love you.
All right, Rick Fredrickson, thank you very much for joining us this morning. Right now, we're going to move on to Los Angeles, where Harvey Levin is standing by. Good morning again. What can you tell us about anything new that has surfaced from the documents that you have had a chance now to look over?
Well, the freshest information that we have right now is that there are five children who were interviewed by the Los Angeles Police Department, including this alleged victim that we've been talking about this week. One of the people is Macaulay Culkin, who was interviewed by the police. We've learned that. We've been told that McCulkin said that there was no improper contact with Michael Jackson. We don't know the status of the interviews with the other children.
So we're not sure at this point what their specific allegations are coming from the other children?
We're not sure that there are allegations from the other children. Indeed, Macaulay Culkin, we're told, denied that there was any improper conduct. What we do know is that the backdrop for this, Paula, is a custody battle. What happened is the father and mother divorced in 1985.
Right.
The mother has the father visitation. Last July 11th, the father had a one-week visitation period with the child. Almost the next day after getting the child, the father apparently went to the mother and said, I want you to sign an order saying this child will not be taken out of Los Angeles County without my consent. And the mother signed that order. And apparently that still didn't satisfy the father. He went into court, filed a petition to remove custody from her. He wanted custody. He also wanted an order saying that there would be absolutely no contact with Michael Jackson, even by telephone. And that was supposed to be heard this month, but what happened is on August 17th, the judge decided that custody would remain with the mother. Mm-hmm. He did not order any prohibition with Michael Jackson. That very day, the father lodged a complaint with the Department of Children's Services Child Abuse Hotline, and that's what triggered the police investigation.
So based on what you're saying, does that in any way reinforce the motivation that publicists say this man has for extorting the figure this being thrown out, some $20 million from Michael Jackson.
There is a charge on the table that the father was trying to extort the $20 million from Michael Jackson. So far, there really hasn't been any proof offered to show that one way or the other. What we do know, though, is that there is a backdrop of a tug of war with this child between the mother and father. The child was interviewed by a therapist with the Department of Children's Services. I found that out yesterday. That very night that the child was interviewed, on August 17th, the child was placed into protective custody. So technically, right now, neither the father nor mother have custody of this child. The custody is with Los Angeles County, though the county is allowing the child to be with the father. There are a number of restrictions apparently placed on the situation now where the child is living in the father's home. But the custody right now technically is with Los Angeles County.
We only have time for one very quick last question. You said it's not clear what the allegations are. If there are allegations coming from the other children that have been questioned, is there anything we know about what took place in those interviews with officials?
Well, the one thing I do know is with the child at the center of this right now, that there was extensive discussion about what kind of physical contact he had with Michael Jackson. There are a number of reports that are circulating around Los Angeles, and I'm not going to mention them all, but the one that that is coming up consistently and I'm hearing from the inside is that the child did discuss the issue of fondling. This was a long interview, at least 2.5 hours, I'm told, and beyond that, there's a lot of speculation as to the nature of the physical contact.
All right, Harvey Levin, thank you so much for joining us. It's early hour of the morning there in Los Angeles. Mark?
Jackson's latest performance was canceled again today because of illness. Back home, new details are emerging in the criminal investigation involving the superstar, including some secretly recorded conversations obtained by CBS News. Correspondent Sandra Hughes has the story.
We love Michael!
Fans gathered outside the hotel in Singapore where Michael Jackson is staying after yet another concert postponement. His doctor says he has a headache.
CBS News has obtained a taped phone conversation. The voices are purportedly the father of the 13-year-old boy who is accusing Michael Jackson of abusing him and the boy's stepfather. The conversation was taped in July before the police began their investigation.
This man is going to be humiliated beyond belief. Yeah. He will not believe it. He will not believe what's going to happen to him.
Yeah.
Beyond his worst nightmares, sell one more record.
If I go through with this, I win big time. I will get everything I want. They will be destroyed forever.
Jackson's private investigator has said all along the accusers were motivated by a failed extortion attempt.
It spells out everything to me that this was an extortion attempt from the very beginning, that it was all planned.
The boy's father, a Beverly Hills dentist, isn't returning phone calls. A recent legal request he made to take custody of the 13-year-old from his mother has been withdrawn. Meantime, Jackson friend Elizabeth Taylor flew to his side for moral support.
I believe totally that Michael will be vindicated. I believe in Michael's integrity, his love and respect of children. I know it will all come out all right.
Today, the Jackson family announced they too will fly to Asia to be with Michael.
I'm behind my son. I don't believe any of this stuff that's being written about him because I raised him and I know him, and that's just a statement people are making.
Fans in Singapore were told to hold on to their tickets for tonight's postponed concert because Jackson would be back on stage Wednesday night. Sandra Hughes, CBS News, Los Angeles.
Still to come on tonight's CBS Evening News. New
doctors in Singapore say a brain scan on pop star Michael Jackson shows nothing abnormal, and they pronounced him fit to perform tomorrow, this after an apparent migraine attack. Back home in California, there's no end to Jackson's headache over child abuse allegations. Correspondent Sandra Hughes has the latest.
Since the allegations of child abuse first surfaced against Michael Jackson, the family of the 13-year-old accuser has kept quiet. Today, CBS News spoke to their private investigator, Ernie Rizzo. He says the boy's father never tried to extort money from Michael Jackson.
It was the Jackson camp, Pelicano, who suggested somewhere between $300,000 and $1 million for an out-of-court type settlement to make this go away.
Jackson's private investigator, Anthony Pelicano, has not yet commented on the latest information. Also, according to today's Los Angeles Times, Pelicano did offer the boy's father a movie deal. valued at approximately $350,000. Jackson's attorney, Howard Weitzman, says that more information of extortion does exist, but it's been turned over to the Los Angeles police.
CBS News has obtained a taped phone conversation purportedly between the boy's father and stepfather. It was recorded in July. Although Michael Jackson's private investigator has said the tape illustrates the claim of extortion, nowhere on the tape is money ever mentioned.
I love him so much that I'm willing to destroy my own life to protect him, to do what I think is the best thing to do. As bad as my life is, I'm willing to let it get a lot worse and sacrifice whatever it is so that my son won't be damaged.
Meantime, as the controversy continues to swirl in the states, overseas, Jackson was taken to a hospital. The superstar was examined, released, and gave yet another taped apology to his fans.
I was suddenly taken ill last night, and I'm sorry for the cancellation of my performance.
Los Angeles police continue to investigate the claims of extortion. No charges have been filed against anyone. Sandra Hughes, CBS News, Los Angeles.
There's more to come on the CBS Evening News.
It's time for more news now this morning. Michael Jackson returned to the stage last night in Singapore while in Los Angeles. His lawyer offered more tapes linked to accusations of child sex abuse. Sandra Hughes has more.
Back on stage in Singapore, the pop icon sang and danced, never mentioning the scandal brewing back home. Accusations by a 13-year-old boy that Michael Jackson molested him. Counter-accusations by private eyes and attorneys of extortion by the boy's father. On Wednesday, Jackson's representatives presented the media with a new taped phone conversation between Jackson's private eye, Anthony Pelicano, and the boy's father's former attorney, Barry Rothman. It occurred August 17th and focused on a movie deal for the boy's father.
I'm willing to give him $350,000 to develop a project.
Out of your pocket, huh?
No, out of Michael's pocket.
Make me a better offer. That's the bottom line.
The tape was played just one day after the boy's father's private investigator said there was no evidence of extortion.
I've already told you that we think that this is an extortion attempt from the beginning.
We did not make a precipitating move in respect to this situation.
After the tape was played, Jackson's attorney had only this to say.
It's our belief that that tape confirms what Mr. Pelicano has told you before with respect to the demands that were made, that the $4 or $5 million totaling $20 million demands.
What Jackson's representatives had said before is that the boy's father demanded $20 million from Michael Jackson. Neither the father nor his current attorney nor Barry Rothman would return our calls to discuss the taped conversation. It's not clear from the discussion just who started the negotiations for the movie deal or if the boy's father was first to discuss money. Sandra Hughes, CBS News, Los Angeles.
Time now for a change of pace. Say you bring home some new gadget that says...
While Michael Jackson supposedly undergoes treatment for a painkiller addiction overseas, a California judge has set a trial date for the civil suit in which a young boy alleges Jackson molested him. Jackson's lawyers say a criminal grand jury is about to hear evidence in the case. They are denying charges in a suit by five former bodyguards who say they were fired as part of a cover-up. We want to go live to Los Angeles now to talk to two reporters who have been covering the story, Harvey Levin of KCBS-TV and Bruce Horovitz of the Los Angeles Times. Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Harvey, let me start with you. Michael Jackson's lawyer comes out first yesterday and says he thinks Michael Jackson's going to be indicted. Then what happens?
Well, they took it back a little bit later, and it really did Michael Jackson some damage, I think. It turns out that the lawyer who said that didn't have all the facts and basically speculated about something that just wasn't so. He said that an indictment was imminent, when in fact the only thing we know is that several subpoenas have gone out and the grand jury may be impaneled to investigate the case. It's possible there could be an indictment, but why Jackson's own lawyer would make that statement just baffles me, because he gained nothing in court by saying it. And I think what he did in the public eye is to make Michael Jackson almost a defendant. So it's really puzzling why they made that statement yesterday.
So we should make it clear that, as best we know, the grand jury has only been impaneled. They have not yet sat down to look at evidence.
That's my understanding. I think that the lawyer just misspoke in court and was trying to be such an advocate that he lost some perspective.
Now, bring us up to date on the civil trial. The judge has, in fact, set a date.
The judge set March 21st as the date. That's a major victory for this 13-year-old boy. And now what's going to happen is that there'll be a number of depositions taken. The boy will have his taken. LaToya Jackson is scheduled to have hers taken. The big question is Michael Jackson. The judge said that the deposition has to be taken by January 30th of next year. And the lawyers are going to have to sit down and figure out when it's going to be taken and in what country. They could agree to go overseas and have it taken in Europe.
So that is possible. It could be taken someplace else.
Absolutely. And then they did not foreclose that option. Yesterday we asked the question and they said it's possible.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And just real quickly, what do you know about these bodyguards? What is the sense about the suit that they're bringing against Jackson?
Well, these were bodyguards who worked between 1990 and 1993, principally at Jackson's parents' home in Encino. And what they're saying is they worked the nighttime shift, that Michael Jackson would often bring young boys to his suite when his parents weren't home or when they went to bed. One guard says that Jackson ordered him to destroy a photograph of a nude boy. What's curious about this case is that they were fired in February. And the allegations in this case emanate from a period between April of this year and July of this year. So they were fired even before the current allegations surfaced. So it's not clear exactly what specifically these guards know. The Jackson people say the case is nonsense, but I spoke with a lawyer in the case, and he says that the security guards have already been interviewed by the district attorney and the police, and they've given the police evidence.
Wow. Bruce, let us talk about Michael Jackson, the superstar, and one of the big headlines of the last month or so was him being dropped or dismissed as an endorser by Pepsi. Is that a big story? Why is that a big story? Or is there more to the story than just a headline?
I must say I don't think it's a big story because he may be the king of pop, but he is most assuredly not the king of Madison Avenue. Michael Jackson has been on and off with Pepsi for 10 years. Pepsi made it clear going into this that they were sponsoring the tour, that they had no commitment past it, to their credit. Michael Jackson does not really have an endorsement career. He was briefly, maybe as long as you can sneeze, with L.A. Gear, the shoemaker. They both ended up suing each other. I believe it might have been settled out of court.
Was that from him, though, or as somebody trying to promote a product? Wouldn't you want the most popular star, a popular pop star in the world, endorsing your product in some way?
Only if it makes sense. There's only two things that make sense probably for him to link up with, and that would be a athletic shoe and a soft drink. He's done that. The athletic shoe didn't work. The soft drink has wrapped up. I'm certain Michael Jackson has done his last moonwalk with Pepsi.
All right. Bruce and Harvey, thank you so much for joining.
Despite his troubles, Michael Jackson has pulled off the biggest music publishing deal in history. Jackson's company signed a deal with EMI worth between $1 and $200 million. Beside his own works, Jackson owns the rights to most songs by the Beatles. Jackson is reportedly undergoing drug treatment in Europe and is facing accusations he molested a 13-year-old boy. There's a new controversy over Michael Jackson's sister LaToya says the allegations of child sex abuse against him are true. Sandra Hughes has more on the latest Jackson bombshell.
Michael Jackson's sister LaToya, promoting her international tour, said she could no longer keep quiet about her famous brother and the allegations of sexual abuse against him.
But I cannot and I will not be a silent collaborator of his crimes against small innocent children.
LaToya says when she lived at the Jackson family home with Michael, there were always young boys staying overnight with him, sharing his bedroom.
I have seen checks payable to the parents of these children. And I've seen these checks through my mother. She's shown me these checks.
Long at odds with her family, LaToya says the rest of the Jacksons must back Michael's denials because he financially supports them. Her remarks brought a scathing response.
LaToya is lying, and I'll tell her to her face she's lying.
There's no validity to what she is saying. It's absolutely not true. My brother is not a child molester.
There was first speculation that Jackson was in this London clinic for treatment for an addiction to painkillers. Recently, it's been reported that he's getting help at this Connecticut facility. Some have said after canceling his world tour and admitting his addiction, Jackson might be posturing to stay out of the United States and away from the allegations that he molested a 13-year-old boy.
I want the people out there to stop thinking that he's hiding and he's running, because he is not running. He will be home.
The Jacksons say LaToya's motivation for yesterday's statements stem from a desire for more money and publicity. Sandra Hughes, CBS News, Los Angeles.
Michael Jackson came out of seclusion today without leaving home. The pop star angrily rejected accusations he molested a young boy and lashed out at police and the media. Correspondent Sandra Hughes has more on Jackson's first appearance in more than a month.
Don't treat me like a criminal, because I am innocent.
This is the first time the world has seen Michael Jackson deny the allegations of sexual abuse. In a message carried on live television from his Santa Barbara ranch, he emotionally described undergoing a recent body search by investigators.
They served a search warrant on me, which allowed them to view and photograph my body. It was the most humiliating ordeal of my life, one that no person should ever have to suffer.
Jackson's defiant declaration of innocence comes as the latest counterpoint in a case that's saturated with rumor, innuendo, and almost daily revelations about the singer. Separating fact from fiction can be difficult.
Here are the facts. A lawsuit filed by a 13-year-old boy charges sexual abuse. A criminal investigation is underway. Former employees are being paid by the media for incriminating statements against Jackson. What's not known is whether the former employees witnessed inappropriate behavior, if a grand jury has been called, or whether other children have made allegations.
I am particularly upset by the handling of this mass matter by the incredible, terrible mass media.
The attorney for the boy suing Jackson says it's ironic Jackson would criticize the media while at the same time holding his own media event.
This is his plea to try to influence a jury, and he's got the money, the power, and the influence to do that.
Jackson's next scheduled appearance is expected in January, when he'll give a deposition in the civil lawsuit. Sandra Hughes, CBS News, Los Angeles.
Well, the match made in rock and roll heaven is over. Lisa Marie Presley and Michael Jackson are going their separate ways. Pat LaLama, KCBS-TV in Los Angeles, has more on the split between the king of pop and the daughter of the king of rock.
Well, he wasn't alone, but he may be now. It's a fact, the matrimonial mating of Lisa Marie Presley and Michael Jackson is history. And we're not talking about Jackson's latest album of the same name. And the so-called king of pop might be checking into the Heartbreak Hotel as he sings it, because Lisa Marie wants Michael to beat it. And she said so in official court papers, citing irreconcilable differences. Translation, they just don't get along. Lisa Marie doesn't indicate what she's hoping for in the way of material goods, but she wants one thing restored, her last name. Global cynics thought it was a dubious duo from the start. Public relations posturing following highly controversial charges that Jackson was a child molester. Not so, say supporters of Jackson. His feelings for Lisa Marie are true. And they hope to clinch that conviction in a network interview. The two revealed they, of course, had a physical relationship. They were in love.
The only official statement from Michael Jackson comes from his publicist, Lee Solders. It says, Michael Jackson and Lisa Marie Presley have mutually agreed to go their own separate ways. However, they remain good friends. Reporting from Los Angeles, Pat LaLama for CBS.
All over between Michael Jackson and Lisa Marie Presley. After a year and a half of marriage, Presley announced today she has filed for divorce. Presley cited what she called, and I quote, irreconcilable differences. The first of the baby boomers are turning 50 this year. Ironically, the generation that grew up watching television has been forgotten by the medium. But as Edie Magnus reports, that's about to change.
Bye-bye.
Okay.
Oh,
my God.
Over 50 and wondering why so little on television appeals to you? You're not alone.
Frankly, for me, I think they're putting on much too much for the younger people.
More than a third of this season's new network shows targeted viewers 18 to 49 years old. Most were clones of the hit comedy Friends, and mostly they made enemies. Primetime ratings plummeted as older viewers turned away.
I think they forgot about our generation already.
Everybody knows that this underserved demographic is out there, that there's an enormous appetite for serving them.
Boy, the way Glenn Miller plays.
Norman Lear, creator of such popular shows as All in the Family and The Jeffersons, is planning a cable network for older Americans next fall. With baby boomers now turning 50 every few seconds.
It's clearly an idea whose time has come.
A second cable venture, Our Time, already airs 2 hours each day. And the Prime Life Network debuts on cable TV this spring.
We thank the networks for doing what they're doing and giving us this huge audience, which is a very, affluent and influential audience.
Why did the networks let this audience slip away? One guess.
You have to go where the money is.
And advertisers pay a premium for programs that reach the young. Older viewers are set in their ways, they say. It's young people who switch brands and spend more money. There's just one problem. That isn't true.
We're the ones with all the money. Do you know that 77% of all the assets in America are owned by people who are post-49?
Another Madison Avenue myth? That mature audiences will watch whatever's in front of them.
You basically can run in almost any show and you're going to reach a great proportion of older viewers.
Wrong again.
They no longer have to settle for programming that's targeted to someone else. They can find something more directly appealing to them.
With the ratings down and the challenge from cable, the networks are now trying to broaden the appeal of their programs as they plan for next fall. Please, no, pretty please, they are asking. Stay tuned. Dan?
Ilya Magnus, thanks.
Time now to switch gears and talk about money.
Yeah.
Everyone thinks stars lead rich lives, but just how rich? In this morning's entertainment report, a guy who is rich in friends, Mark McKeown, has a sneak peek at the new Forbes magazine, the list of the richest people in the country.
They're so rich they pronounce it Monet instead of Monet. Good morning.
Mr. Monet.
Good morning, Jay. Good morning, Jose. Hi, everybody. Okay, how'd you like to open your weekly paycheck and see a number, say, like, $3,288,000 per week? Well, for one very talented lady, that's not just a lot of talk.
According to Forbes magazine, Oprah just keeps on gaining. Money, that is. She's taken over the top spot as the world's richest entertainer, with a combined 95-96 income of $171 million. That bumps Steven Spielberg down to number two, with a mere intake of $150 million.
Oprah, she's almost, in a sense, a money machine. She just, the show just keeps getting bigger, and the ratings just stay where they are, and the revenues of that show, the ad rates, they just keep going up.
Rounding out the top five are the Beatles, still making $130 million nearly three decades after their breakup. Michael Jackson with $90 million, and the Rolling Stones with $77 million. And speaking of rock and roll, this year Forbes says retread rock hit a high note. The 70s band Kiss reunited with a sellout tour and made a surprising $35 million. The reunited Eagles continued to soar, earning $75
million. There's not enough hatred in the world to keep these guys apart when someone hands them a $100 million check and says, okay, make an album, hit the road, we'll do a video.
And guess who's laughing all the way to the bank?
I don't know.
Comedy is the cash cow king, with Bill Cosby making $33 million. And Jerry Seinfeld was the $59 million man, pulling down a reported $1 million per episode of his hit sitcom.
So that's how it's gonna be?
That's how it's gonna be.
Oh, God help us!
I can't believe I just missed the top 10 by one. It's very, very frustrating.
Frustrated. He can't even carry the money he's making. He came in at number 11, by the way. Of course, they handed out the Emmy Awards last night in Hollywood. Among the winners, Kathy Baker, honored as Best Dramatic Actress for her role in the former CBS drama Picket Fences. Her colleague Ray Walston snapped up the Best Supporting Actor Award for the second year in a row.
And you were in Hollywood this weekend. Can we tell?
Yeah, did a little Murphy Brown episode this week. It'll be on the 23rd.
How fun.
Yeah. Was it fun?
A lot of fun.
McEwen goes to primetime.
Candace getting to call her Murph. All right. Now, coming up on our second hour of this morning, I'll take you behind the scenes at last night's big Emmy Award show. There were loads of surprises. Mm-hmm.
Also, in the next hour, we'll get the latest on the aftermath of the devastating storm.
And it looks like the King's little girl has tied the knot again. Lisa Marie Presley, who was previously married Jackson, reportedly married actor Nicolas Cage over the weekend. The ceremony reportedly took place at a hotel in Hawaii. Now here's Dan Rather.
News headquarters in New York.
Good evening. For years, pop star Michael Jackson has denied having inappropriate contact with children, and he has never been charged. But tonight, Jackson is wanted by police. California authorities announced an arrest warrant today, accusing Jackson, age 45, of multiple felony counts of child molestation. It's important to note that there is no rape charge against Jackson. Police who swarmed through Jackson's Neverland Ranch yesterday and seized evidence said they are working on a deal for Jackson's surrender. CBS's Vince Gonzalez has late details.
Michael Jackson was last seen earlier this month on a shopping spree in Las Vegas as he prepared to shoot a music video. Now, with a warrant out for his arrest, the self-proclaimed King of Pop is believed to still be there, in seclusion, as his new high-profile lawyer, Mark Garagos, negotiates his surrender to California authorities.
The service of the warrants was part of an ongoing investigation alleging criminal misconduct on the part of Michael Jackson.
More than 60 investigators searched Jackson's Neverland Ranch for 14 hours yesterday. Jackson's lawyer says a 12-year-old boy claims he was molested there. Today, the local district attorney seemed almost gleeful as he spoke to the media. He tried to prosecute Jackson for molestation 10 years ago, but the singer settled a civil suit with the alleged victim in exchange for the boy's silence.
These statements about me are totally false.
No charges were ever filed, but this time the alleged victim is cooperating, and it's easier to file a case thanks to a change in state law.
And it was changed specifically because of the 1993-94 Michael Jackson investigation.
Concerns about Jackson's conduct were revived last year when he dangled one of his children off a balcony and told a British interviewer he enjoyed sharing his bed with children.
But when you say bed, you're thinking sexual. They make that sexual. It's not sexual. But we're going to sleep.
Jackson's biographer thinks avoiding charges 10 years ago may have made him reckless.
It feels to me like it emboldened him to make a decision to do whatever he wanted to do and live his life his way and the hell with everybody.
Late today, a Jackson spokesperson called the allegations false and malicious, saying, quote, Michael would never harm a child in any way, and promised the singer would put this nightmare behind him. Vince Gonzalez, CBS News, Los Angeles.
Whatever happens in a court of law,
that Michael Jackson, facing multiple counts of child molestation, will turn himself into authorities in Santa Barbara today. Early show national correspondent Hattie Kaufman is in Santa Barbara with more. Good morning, Hattie.
Good morning, Julie. Sources close to Jackson tell us that he will be surrendering here in Santa Barbara County, but the clock is ticking. He has only a limited amount of time to voluntarily surrender to face those serious multiple felony charges involving the alleged sexual abuse of a 12-year-old boy who was a guest at Neverland Ranch.
The bail amount on the warrant has been set at $3 million.
The warrant for Jackson's arrest comes after nearly 70 detectives combed his Neverland Ranch looking for evidence that he molested a 12-year-old boy.
This young boy told authorities that Michael Jackson used wine to make the boy more relaxed in order to allegedly perform some sort of wrong activity.
The pop star's spokesperson issued a statement saying these scurrilous and totally unfounded allegations will be proven false in a courtroom. The molestation charges echo a claim made 10 years ago by another boy. At that time, Jackson said,
these statements about me are totally false.
Jackson was never charged in 1993. After the singer made a multi-million-dollar settlement with the boy's family, the child refused to cooperate with authorities. Jackson has suggested the new charges are an attempt to harm his career.
Jackson himself, I believe, has said that this was all done to try to ruin his new CD that was coming out or whatever it is he's doing. Like, the sheriff and I really are into that kind of music.
In an interview last year, Jackson revealed he sleeps with children.
When you say bed, You're thinking sexual. They make that sexual. It's not sexual. But we're going to sleep. I tuck them in. We put. I put a little like music on.
I have been writing about this for years. You know that that the appropriate thing for Michael to do, in my view and in the view of a lot of people, is to not have this fascination with children.
Thousands of children have visited the Neverland Ranch. Could there be other victims?
There is that possibility, and we would encourage the public to come forward if they have any information whatsoever that would lead us to believe there are other victims.
In addition to thoroughly combing Neverland Ranch, authorities reportedly searched several film and video businesses in Southern California, seizing pictures and videos of Michael Jackson with children. Julie?
Hattie Kaufman in Santa Barbara. Thank you, Hattie. As we all know, Michael Jackson first took center stage.
There are new details in the Michael Jackson case. The alleged molestation victim is at the center of a custody dispute. Early Show national correspondent Hattie Kaufman has more.
Who's at fault for letting the boy go to the house and spend the night with Michael Jackson?
That, well, clearly is his ex-wife.
Russ Halpern represented the father of the boy who claims Michael Jackson molested him. He defended the man against criminal charges that grew out of a bitter divorce.
Is it within the realm of probability or possibility that this woman's making up this story? The answer is yes.
This isn't the couple's first contact with the courts. CBS News has learned in 1998 they filed a lawsuit against JCPenney, claiming store security guards followed them into the mall parking lot and proceeded to beat them, and that a Tower Records security guard joined the fracas, sexually assaulted the boy's mother in front of him.
She had actually written out a script for the children to say when they were their deposition was going to be taken.
They settled for more than $150,000. Jackson's accuser is reportedly the boy in this documentary.
So I finally slept on the bed, but it was fun that night.
I slept on the floor.
Jackson called the documentary terrible and unfair. After it aired, according to Newsweek magazine, Jackson's camp offered to relocate the family to Latin America to avoid media glare, going so far as to secure passports. Now on Jackson's new website, he claims the molestation charges are predicated on a big lie.
She's done it before. She could do it again. Now maybe in this case, Mr. Jackson is guilty and she didn't do anything to encourage her child.
Only the district attorney knows what evidence seized at Neverland Ranch may corroborate the boy's story. Hattie Kaufman, CBS News, Los Angeles.
A California prosecutor has apologized for making jokes when he announced an arrest warrant had been issued for Michael Jackson. Santa Barbara County District Attorney Thomas Sneddon bantered with reporters last week, joked at a news conference about the child molestation charges against Jackson. Sneddon now admits some of his comments were, quote, inappropriate. Still ahead on tonight's CBS Evening News.
It was the paper walk witnessed by the world's press, documents hand-carried and filed with the court clerk in Santa Maria, California, listing the sexual molestation charges against entertainer Michael Jackson. Seven counts of lewd and lascivious acts against a child with the intent of arousing, appealing to, and gratifying the lust, passions, and sexual desires of Jackson and the child. And two counts of administering an intoxicating agent, reportedly alcohol, with the intent of committing child molestation.
There are several special allegations that have been alleged. The findings could make Mr. Jackson ineligible for probation and could substantially affect the amount of time that he could spend incarcerated.
From reading these charges, it doesn't look like just a caressing the child type of case. There was substantial sexual conduct that is alleged.
There were no explicit details, but the charges seemed to mirror those leveled by this boy in 1993. Jackson was never charged in that case, reaching a huge financial settlement before criminal charges could be filed. That boy, like the accuser in the current case, originally denied Jackson ever abused him. Child therapist Mattis Abrams interviewed the boy in the 93 case and says conflicting statements by alleged child victims are not uncommon.
Children may be frightened at first of the system, of the whole pressure.
But District Attorney Sneddon says these crimes occurred after the boy told child welfare investigators that nothing had happened.
To call that an investigation is a misnomer.
Jackson's attorney blasted everyone.
And what we have here is an intersection between a shakedown, somebody who's looking for money, with somebody, an investigation, that's got an axe to grind.
Jackson's been given approval to be out of the country for the holidays to go to England to promote his new CD. But he's supposed to be back here on January 16th to face the formal arraignment. Dan?
All right. right, thanks a lot, Dave. As we've been reporting, child molestation charges are expected to be filed today against Michael Jackson. Tom Sneddon has been the district attorney in Santa Barbara, California, for more than 20 years and plans to personally try the case. Early Show National correspondent Hattie Kaufman has more on the veteran prosecutor.
I think people do feel that he is a man on a mission. This is going to be the signature case of his career.
Santa Barbara District Attorney Tom Sneddon has pursued Michael Jackson twice over 10 years on allegations of child molestation. The editor of the local paper says, don't look for Sneddon to back down.
The two words that you hear the most are probably pugnacious and tenacious. He has a reputation for being fiercely competitive.
Within a very short period of time, there will be charges filed against Mr. Jackson.
When Sneddon announced an arrest warrant for Jackson, he sounded confident and cocky.
Like the sheriff and I really are into that kind of music, but...
He was forced later to apologize for the light tone.
I suspect that if he had the opportunity to do it again, he may do it a little differently.
In over two decades as DA, Sneddon's clashed with plenty of defense attorneys, including Gary Dunlap.
Last year, I was wrongfully prosecuted for a number of crimes that I did not commit.
The DA had charged Dunlap, a frequent critic of the department, with perjury and witness intimidation.
We went to a jury trial, and I was acquitted on all counts.
Now Dunlap is suing Sneddon for malicious prosecution and wonders just how strong the DA's case against Jackson really is.
He said he had a very strong case against me. The problem was that his whole strong case was manufactured.
2 years after Jackson's first child molestation investigation by Sneddon, the singer wrote a song about a cold, cold man named Dom Sheldon. Some Jackson fans are convinced it's a thinly veiled reference to Tom Sneddon.
He is not a universally beloved figure. He's not the kind of guy that you feel all warm and fuzzy when he walks into the room.
Still, even his detractors concede Sneddon is good at what he does.
I know he's a very effective prosecutor. Tom Sneddon is not a lightweight.
Some of the talking heads I think that I've seen on national television I think do underestimate him, and I think people underestimate him at their peril.
Jackson's high-profile legal team will be up against a district attorney who plans to prosecute the case himself.
It's not a vendetta. He's a professional, and he's not one that is going to look back and say, you know, we didn't get you last time, we got you this time.
He lost his opportunity against Michael Jackson in 1993, and he doesn't want to leave office without paying that score back.
But Sneddon's motivation may be simpler than that.
He's a law and order guy who sees the world in black and white. There's bad guys and good guys, and he sees himself as the good guy.
For The Early Show, Hattie Kaufman, CBS News, Los Angeles.
Michael Jackson is expected to make his first court appearance next month.
Her torch was snuffed.
Maybe that diatribe at the tribal council. Yeah, all right. First, though, right to our top story. Michael Jackson back in court. As we've been reporting, Jackson will be arraigned in California this morning on child molestation charges. He said earlier this week that his life is at stake and he's expected to plead not guilty. CBS News correspondent Vince Gonzalez is outside the courthouse in Santa Maria. Hi, Vince.
Good morning, Renee. Perhaps deciding that the best defense is a new defense, Michael Jackson is expected to arrive here later this morning with his latest attorney, Thomas Mesereau. Last night, fans of the pop singer gathered outside Jackson's Neverland Ranch for a candlelight vigil. Busloads of them are expected here later today. But we're told the defense has asked them to tone down their protests. And Jackson himself is expected to be more subdued. We're told to expect little drama outside the courthouse as the secret charges in the grand jury indictment are read inside the courtroom.
There probably won't be any fancy footwork by Michael Jackson at today's arraignment. Another noticeable change, the Nation of Islam is no longer overseeing his personal security, but local police will be on guard.
The most important thing here is the protection and safety of Mr. Jackson. Contrary to what he thinks everybody loves him. There may be somebody in that crowd that is not fond of him just based on the allegations.
Fans will be kept farther away from the pop singer, who this time is expected to arrive on time and steer clear of the spotlight.
I think there was a very panicked reaction to the indictment. I think he's got to be totally selfish and centered, that this is not anything but very serious business.
So would you say then the indictment was a wake-up call for Jackson?
I would say that the indictment was a wake-up call. I think it's also was a triggering event for changing counsel.
Jackson's new attorney, Thomas Mesereau, may have a tough job ahead, and not just in the courtroom.
Do you think he'll be able to control
Michael Jackson?
Well, that's the $50 question. Controlling Michael Jackson means controlling the family, the business interests. That's a Herculean task.
Sources say Jackson and his children will soon return to Neverland Ranch. In a statement, Jackson family attorney Brian Oxman says the King of Pop told him, "I'm not going to be driven away anymore. This is where my children were born. This is where I want them to be." CBS News has also learned Jackson's defense team will likely challenge the grand jury indictment, including the unprecedented secrecy surrounding the comings and goings of the grand jurors.
Michael Jackson has basically been barbecued every day since this began, and his defense counsel is going to be pressured to show some of the unfairness.
The case may also be taking a toll on Jackson's young accuser. Celebrity Justice says testifying before the grand jury was especially difficult for him.
We've learned after Jackson's accuser and his mother testified, they were emotionally distraught. They wanted to throw in the towel, walk away from this.
Apparently, the family of the alleged victim was eventually convinced to stay on the case.
These are fragile people, and it's going to be a task to keep them on board and to keep them strong. It remains to be seen.
Now, we're going to learn exactly what the charges are against Michael Jackson later this morning. We're told the judge will deal quickly with any challenges to the indictment and any motions to delay the trial. Michael Jackson could be on trial as early as the end of this year or the beginning of 2005. Renee.
Watching events closely, CBS's Vince Gonzalez in Santa Maria.
Right, thanks a lot, Harry. Here in California, there could be a dramatic courtroom showdown today as Michael Jackson could come face to face with the mother of the teenage boy he's accused of molesting. CBS News correspondent Vince Gonzalez has more on today's proceedings at the courthouse in Santa Maria, California.
Michael Jackson doesn't have to be in court today, but he and his famous family are expected anyway. The singer, who's facing molestation charges, is reportedly going because his defense team is forcing the mother of his young accuser to testify. The defense hopes to pick apart her story before the trial begins. The mother, dubbed Jane Doe by the court, was also the subject of heated discussion yesterday. Both prosecutors and the defense were upset that this tape of a police interview with her was leaked. On the tape, broadcast by the syndicated program The Insider, Doe tells investigators she fears for her family's safety.
Because there was people that were going to kill the children and me, mostly my children.
Who's telling you this?
Michael's people.
She also claims Jackson's people wanted to send her to Brazil so they could keep her quiet and get access to her apartment.
My apartment was meaningless to them until I told them about that there was letters there from Michael.
Investigative journalist Art Harris obtained the tape for The Insider. He says it paints a sympathetic picture of Doe.
Of course, the defense has raised money as a motive by the mother, but on this tape, she says that it's not. She says her motives are pure and that she just wants justice.
God handpicked me and the kids because he knew that we weren't going to fall for any of their money, that it was going to be justice more than anything.
Well, and that's what we're trying to do here.
Doe says she called police after her son changed.
You could see he's nervous, frightened. No, Mommy, you're messing up the plan. You're messing up the plan.
On this part of the tape, the mother talks about behavioral changes in her son that she picked up on, but didn't know what they meant. She knew that the boy was happy, bubbly initially, and suddenly he was withdrawn, and he was unhappy, was crying, had nightmares. And so she started putting, she thought, two and two together and asking a lot of questions, and did not think that the child being with Michael Jackson was the best idea.
Both sides say they are furious about the leak, but it's a common strategy in high-profile cases.
The essence of this is, who released it? And I think it probably may have come from someone in the prosecution's team as a preemptive strike, as a way of getting this mother's testimony out there without her being subject to cross-examination.
Today, another round of hearings will be scheduled, and more motions will surely be filed in the future. The judge wants this case to go to trial by the end of January, but many observers doubt that date will hold. Vince Gonzalez, CBS News, Santa Maria, California.
Jackson's lawyers also showed the judge a videotape in an effort to prove that police illegally gathered evidence from the singer's Neverland Ranch. Now back to Renee in New York.
All right, thanks so much for your insights this morning.
Thank you.
Russ.
Thanks, Gretchen. Investigators spent another day combing through Michael Jackson's Neverland Ranch on Friday. They would not say what they were looking for, but as Jackson's child molestation trial date approaches, the judge is growing impatient with these continued searches. CBS News correspondent Vince Gonzalez reports.
Sheriff's investigators, armed with a search warrant, were back at Michael Jackson's Neverland Ranch Friday, just weeks before the singer is due to be tried on molestation charges. Deputies spent a good part of the day at the ranch. Officials would only say their activities are part of an ongoing criminal investigation. The singer's ranch was first raided in November of last year when 60 law enforcement officers searched buildings and took away evidence. Most details of what they seized have been kept secret by the judge. He recently scolded prosecutors for asking for new search warrants, telling them it was time to stop investigating and prepare for trial. Some experts say this latest visit to the self-proclaimed King of Pop's home may show prosecutors are concerned about the strength of their case and are looking for more evidence.
To serve search warrants so late in the game suggests that the prosecution doesn't have what it's been looking for.
Others say prosecutors may just be following up on new leads or are being extra thorough due to the media spotlight on the case. Jackson was reportedly at the ranch when investigators arrived, but was allowed to leave. It's been a year since he was accused of molesting this boy at Neverland, and the court fight has already been nasty. Just last week, the judge denied a defense request for psychological evaluations of the boy and his family. Jackson's trial is scheduled to begin at the end of January, but attorneys are already saying the new searches make a delay very likely. Vince Gonzalez, CBS News, Los Angeles.
The crowds are still keeping vigil in Kiev. Russ.
Okay, Gretchen, thank you very much. Michael Jackson threw a party for 200 kids Friday at his Neverland Ranch in California. They came by car and bus to play in Jackson's amusement park.
Was invited, so we thought we'd bring the kids up to see one of our icons, you know, one of our music icons.
And I was so in a hurry to get here to support Michael and to come to Neverland that I forgot to even put my teeth in.
Jackson, who faces a trial next month on child molestation charges, did not mingle with his guests but called out to them from the driveway, wishing them a Merry Christmas.
In Georgia, a stranded cow is finally out of
the American Medical Association. First, though, here's Julie.
All right, thanks a lot, ladies. Well, it could be a pivotal day in Michael Jackson's child molestation case. In a pretrial hearing today, prosecutors are expected to ask the judge to allow the testimony of seven boys with ties to the pop star, including the first one to level sexual abuse charges against Jackson a decade ago. Defense attorney Trent Copeland is a CBS News legal analyst. Good morning, Trent.
Good morning, Julie.
Who are these six other boys, and what kind of testimony does the prosecution hope to draw from these males?
Well, you know, look, first, Julie, this is an effort on the part of the prosecution to introduce evidence of other claims of molestation against Michael Jackson. These former boys, or these young men at this stage, are probably victims or alleged victims, according to the prosecution, who've also claimed that they've been molested by Michael Jackson. Now, the prosecution, strangely enough, really only intends to call one of those victims, according to the defense, although they intend to introduce evidence that he molested all six of them. So this is a risky strategy. I think if it works, Julie, clearly it could be a devastating blow to the defense, and I think the results of this ruling today will resonate throughout this trial.
Is it safe to say that perhaps because the prosecution wants to bring these unproven allegations into this case, that maybe this case right. is not all that strong?
You know, look, that clearly is a problem for the prosecution, Julie. And I think really what the defense will point out is that, you know, if this case, the underlying case of which the prosecution is moving forward with, was so strong, they wouldn't need to bring in these previous uncharged, unproven allegations. But, you know, again, there's a new law that went into effect back in 1995. It really hasn't been used very much here in California. Many regard that law as having went into effect because of the Michael Jackson case back in 1993. And that law essentially says that the prosecution is allowed to bring in this kind of evidence. So I think the judge is primed to really allow the prosecution to bring in this evidence. And the question will remain whether or not the jury buys it, whether or not the jury sees the strength of this case as a result of Michael Jackson having had, according to the prosecution, a propensity or a habit or a pattern of doing this kind of thing in the past.
So you think the judge is going to rule yes in favor of the prosecution here? I mean, it sounds kind of unusual, even though there is a law that allows it.
You know, I think he is, Julie. It's called propensity evidence, as we said. I think the judge will probably allow this evidence to come in. I think it will create all kinds of problems for this trial. It will be a trial within a trial, because Michael Jackson's defense team is not going to sit idly by and allow these unproven, uncharged acts to go unchallenged. So it really will lengthen the trial, and we know from the Scott Peterson case that whenever trials are extended and protracted, it is really rife with problems from jurors falling out of the case to misconduct and all the like.
In the final 10 seconds, the boy who dropped charges more than a decade ago, if he doesn't want to testify, he might be required to, is that correct?
That is correct, Julie. He could be held in contempt of court if he refuses to show up for a subpoena.
We'll stay tuned. Correct. We'll stay tuned and see what happens. Trent Copeland, thank you.
You bet, Julie.
And now here's
sometimes I get so angry I cry. Sometimes I get so sad I cry.
The Jackson clan is closing ranks around Michael. His parents, Catherine and Joe Jackson, a constant presence at the pretrial hearings, will be back in court for the trial.
I can't talk too much about the case, but I know my son, and this is ridiculous. We have a lot of wicked people out there, and they know what they're doing.
Jackson's parents sat down with international interviewer Daphne Barak to give their side of the story.
They don't know him. They don't even know what they're talking about. But they have to remember there's a family out there that love that person they're lying on and talking about, and especially a mother. And she have feelings.
In their view, Santa Barbara District Attorney Tom Sneddon is out to get their son.
Jackson himself, I believe, has said that this was all done to try to ruin his new CD that was coming out or whatever it is he's doing. Like, the sheriff and I really are into that kind of music, but...
When he raided my son's ranch and he got on television that evening, I think he showed his true colors. They don't call him Mad Dog for nothing.
That started with the media. And the media, they don't never check a story out before they come out with it, especially when it's on Michael. We know our son. We know that he's not a pedophile like some of these newscasters are saying.
How would you describe a pedophile?
A pedophile is someone that, well, they prey on children. You put them in jail and you can keep them for 15 years. They come out and they do the same thing and they go right back to jail. That's what a pedophile is. A pedophile is nobody, not anyone like they're trying to say that they strike every 10 years.
It's been a little over a decade since Jackson paid a settlement to a boy making a similar allegation, a settlement that they think made Jackson a target.
It's terrible what they're trying to do to him. And I know what it's all about, you know. It's about money.
J. Randy Terabarelli has been a Jackson biographer for three decades.
This is make it or break it time. For Michael and for the family. I've often thought that where Michael Jackson goes, so goes the family. You know, he is the golden child, and I think that you're going to see them bond together like never before.
As they come together, Michael's younger brother Randy is taking a bigger role.
I guess you just got tired of Michael saying yes to everybody, and you walking in and sit to say no.
Randy is now running Michael's camp. Is that surprising to you?
It's surprising. I remember Randy when he was about that big, you know, and Randy has always been very enterprising and very smart. What I think is really relevant is the fact that Michael has, for I think the first time in his history, really turned to his family for support.
The Nation of Islam bodyguards, who were so prevalent during earlier court dates, may now have a smaller role.
They ain't never been 100% in. The bodyguards are still there, I think, aren't they? Yes. they're still protecting Michael, and they have to. Mm-hmm. Yes. Because you got some mean people out there, I'm telling you.
What upsets the Jackson parents most is one word, wacko.
How could they call him wacko? They sold more records than anybody in show business history. The song We Are the World, he wrote 80% of that song.
He's not that wacko to be number one in the world.
The fixation on Michael's plastic surgery also annoys them.
Michael didn't have a big nose when he was small. When Michael went through his adolescent age stages, then his nose grew bigger. But when he was a little kid, his nose wasn't that big.
Do you know how many plastic surgeries is done to actors and actresses in Hollywood? How many operations did Michael have? One or two?
I don't know, Joe.
They fret that the accusations have hurt record sales, but they're confident when it's over, Michael Jackson will still be the king of pop.
Of course he can resume his career. This is just the United States. All the rest of the countries all over the world are very, very proud of Michael. It's here we have the most trouble out of it.
Why do you think it's such a problem in America? Why do you think...
Come on. You don't want me to answer that, do you?
No, don't answer it.
Shall I?
No, Jill, just shut up. Stop it.
No. I don't want to cut through the chase on this one.
Stop it.
It is racism. It is. Catherine's not going to say it, but I will say it. It is racism.
Will that be an argument heard in court as well? For The Early Show, Hattie Kaufman, CBS News, Los Angeles.
He was the type of kid, you couldn't keep him still. You had to keep your eyes on him at all times.
He was the kind of person that kids loved him. All the kids would draw close to Michael. But when he got to California, there was a lot of work for him to do because he was the lead singer.
Catherine and Joe Jackson spoke to international interviewer Daphne Barak. They reminisced about the first time Michael stole the show.
The kids were all in the room singing, and Michael hadn't yet joined the group, but they were singing a song, and Michael, about 4 years old, sitting over in the corner, joined in perfect harmony. And I thought, oh my God, this kid can sing, can harmonize, and where'd he get it from?
Well, from his parents, of course, the creators of the Jackson Five.
We created the most famous group in the world. So I have to make a give credit where credit is due here, okay?
Stop it. Let other people give you credit. You don't give yourself credit.
When did the family move to this house?
Last fall, Jermaine Jackson gave me a tour of the mansion his parents bought when the Jackson Five shot to fame. These days, it's home to Michael's nieces and nephews.
I believe that we will be.
So do you feel pressure since you're like maybe the next generation of Jacksons? Look, I got five sitting right here.
Sometimes, but not all the time because, you know, they don't pressure us to be something that we don't want to be.
Unlike the grandkids, Michael Jackson has publicly complained that his father pushed him to perform.
Michael never complained about being on stage. I think he loved it.
Yeah, he did. He really loved being on stage.
But Jackson complained he never had a childhood, raising the question, was Joe Jackson too strict? Ironically, Joe and Catherine praise the kind of parent Michael has turned out to be.
He's playful with them, but he's very stern with them, too. When they do things wrong, he corrects them. And he never struck him or anything like that. He always said, I never hit my kid.
She explained why Jackson named his son Prince.
My father's name was Prince, my grandfather's name was Prince, and my great-grandfather's name was Prince.
Wow.
And everybody thinks that Michael named this child Prince because he was the king of pop. That is not the truth.
This is who we all name our kids after. I have a prince, Michael has a prince.
The parents of the Jackson clan continue to champion their kids' careers, pointing out that Jermaine is still recording and chastising Janet for last year's Super Bowl wardrobe malfunction.
I called her and I told her, I said, you know what? I'm the first one to tell you that that shouldn't have happened. It was wrong, but it was blown out of proportion. And what I didn't like about it is it wasn't one person on that stage. There were two people.
And it wasn't one person. Janet didn't pull that thing over herself. He did it.
That's what I'm saying.
I think that it's been really difficult for the Jacksons to avoid the notion of victimization. They have felt victimized by the media, sometimes by the fans, by the public, and sometimes by each other.
The heads of the family, a family that went from poverty to superstardom, have no regrets.
Do I think I've been a good mother? Of course I've been a good mother. I've always given my children the right values.
No, we didn't make no mistakes. We didn't make no mistakes.
Joe, don't say that. You don't know.
I don't make no mistake. I was feeding them every day. They had food in their hands. And then when you have those many kids, you know, you got to keep bread in their hands. And they ate, really. Little kids like, they ate.
It's practically a Greek tragedy in the sense that when you think about what they've achieved and where they came from, and for them to now end up in a courthouse in Santa Maria, and I'm sure that they are finding themselves completely heartbroken.
And what do they consider their greatest achievement?
My biggest achievement when I learned about God. I talk to my grandchildren sometimes about the Bible, and I have been studying with them, and I'm going to continue to study with them.
I think her biggest achievement was when she had all those boys, you know, and girls. She had them all. And that was my biggest achievement when I got them and she had them. That was the biggest achievement. They become the biggest entertainers in the world.
For The Yearly Show, Hattie Kaufman, CBS News, Los Angeles.
Action figures. U.S. officials say there are no missing troops in Iraq. In Santa Maria, California, pop star Michael Jackson's trial is ahead of schedule. On Tuesday, the judge said no more potential jurors are needed in this child molestation case. CBS News correspondent Vince Gonzalez reports.
With the judge deciding the first phase of jury selection is over, Michael Jackson watched his case get closer to trial.
I live in London.
While dedicated fans from several countries descended on the town of Santa Maria.
I want the fans to know, I want the general public to know. I believe in Michael, I'm proud to represent him.
I study it, I went to every details of the case, and I came to this conclusion that this was bogus.
Their screams of support have been heard around the world. As this small community takes center stage.
Das Gericht von Santa Maria vor.
In Santa Maria, in California.
Let's go back to Santa Maria, in California. You'll come to know that name very well over the next 6 months.
No matter what language, the king of pop's name sounds the same.
Michael Jackson,
with foreign and American media ringing the courthouse, reporters who covered past celebrity trials, like the O.J. Simpson case, say that was just a prelude.
I don't know if we'll see O.J. paling in comparison to Michael Jackson, but this will definitely ratchet it up a bit. This is going to be a celebrity trial like no other celebrity trial we've ever had.
The singer's week in court was cut short by a surprise move from the judge, who decided he has enough local residents to fill a jury pool. But with attorneys on both sides having nearly limitless challenges, more residents could be called in. Once jury selection is over, the Jackson trial is expected to take 6 months. Vince Gonzalez, CBS News, Santa Maria, California.
And former President Bill Clinton has been given two new jobs.
From its very beginning today, Michael Jackson's molestation trial comes down to a he said, he said, both between Jackson and his young accuser, and between Jackson's attorney Tom Mesereau and District Attorney Tom Snedden. Snedden presents his overview to the jury first. He tried to prosecute Jackson in the past for the same type of accusation, and some observers think his zealousness might work against him.
So if it becomes about Tom Snedden, he's in trouble, because I'm not sure all the jurors will appreciate how emotionally invested he seems to be.
For the defense, Mesereau will make the argument that children lie, and that the mother of the accuser has a history of making her children lie. Still, Mesereau, who has a reputation for winning tough cases, has to fight the perception his client is an odd man who seems to have an unnatural fondness for little boys.
I think that Tom Mesereau most likely is the right attorney for Michael Jackson. That doesn't mean that he wins, because he's not a magician, he's a lawyer.
And CBS News has learned this man shaking Jackson's hand, Gary Dunlap, has joined the defense as a lawyer. He himself was prosecuted by Tom Snedden 2 years ago for perjury and filing false documents, but was acquitted. Now he's suing Snedden for $10 million for malicious prosecution. What's he doing helping out the king of pop?
I think that he's going to bring a venomous passion to this defense. He knows Tom Snedden inside and out.
This case was expected to take 5 or 6 months, but things are moving fast. Both Snedden and Mesereau have indicated to the judge they expect to be done with their opening arguments by the end of the day today, and the first prosecution witness could be called Tuesday morning. Vince Gonzalez, CBS News, Santa Maria, California.
I sleep in bed with all of them. When Macaulay Culkin were little, Kieran Culkin would sleep on this side, Macaulay Culkin's on this side.
Problem, when you actually invite children into your bed, you never know what's gonna happen.
But when you say bed, you're thinking sexual. They make that sexual, it's not sexual. You know, we have little cookies, it's very charming.
Is this case going to reach a point where people are going to be hearing things they just want to tell
you? Yeah, oh, absolutely. I mean, you know, we already know enough about the story to know that there are going to be moments in court that are graphic and gross. This case is not the most important case in American history. It's important because people know about Michael Jackson.
Mesereau said, quote, "The most vulnerable celebrity, Michael Jackson, became that mark." The first prosecution witness takes the stand on Tuesday. Vince Gonzalez, CBS News, Santa Maria, California.
At the trial of Michael Jackson today, the jury heard his teenage accuser testify that Jackson molested him twice after they drank alcohol, and the day started with the judge becoming furious at Jackson. Vince Gonzalez is in Santa Maria, California tonight and has the story.
Another high-speed SUV race down a California freeway. It must mean a celebrity court case has taken a twist. This is Michael Jackson's motorcade rushing to the courthouse after the judge in the singer's molestation trial threatened to throw the king of pop in jail. That's because Jackson was a no-show at court. Lead defense attorney Tom Mesereau told the judge Jackson was at this hospital with a severe back problem. The judge didn't buy it and gave Jackson an hour to get to court.
And this judge is angry.
Jackson missed the judge's deadline by a few minutes. The usually well-dressed singer shuffled in wearing what appeared to be pajama bottoms and a t-shirt. His trial resumed almost immediately. Jury selection was delayed last month when the singer checked into another hospital with the flu. Not unusual, says CBS consultant and Jackson biographer J. Randy Taraborelli.
You were not surprised by what happened today.
Well, people in Michael Jackson's circle are not surprised by what happened today. You know, people who know Michael know that he does not handle stress well, that he is prone to panic attacks.
Jackson's medical problem came the day his young accuser returned to the stand to discuss the alleged molestation. But it might not just be the trial stressing Jackson out. CBS News has learned he also has a new financial crisis on his hands. Apparently, staff at his Neverland Ranch staged a sick out because they haven't been paid in weeks. Animals in the singer's zoo may have to be moved. His lawyers have reportedly not been paid in months.
Our information is that Michael was up all night long last night dealing with his troubles at Neverland. They only need $150,000 to straighten out this mess at Neverland.
But the singer may be having trouble raising the money. In the courtroom, the young accuser spoke of Jackson touching him inappropriately. But all that was overshadowed by what happened outside the courthouse. Vince Gonzalez, CBS News, Santa Maria, California.
And for those of you who like to keep track of this sort of thing, Forbes magazine is out with its list of the top 20 billionaires. Some familiar names at the top. Bill Gates of Microsoft, number one. He's worth 40.
Hey.
With fans cheering in falsetto, Michael Jackson, who was almost thrown in jail last week, arrived early Monday for his trial on molestation charges. In court, the singer showed no emotion as his young accuser admitted he twice told a dean at his old middle school, Jeffrey Alpert, that Jackson never touched him. The teen said, quote, "I told him that Michael didn't do anything to me." This investigation has been going on for more than 2 years, but the prosecution reportedly first interviewed Alpert only on Saturday, nearly 2 weeks into the trial.
Nothing good came of this day for prosecutors, not a single thing.
Defense attorney Tom Mesereau also went through the boy's school records, pointing to a series of teachers who called him disruptive, defiant, and strong-willed. One teacher even wrote he had good acting skills.
He does not come off as a victim. He comes off as someone who is much more likely to victimize someone else. Everyone knew this was crucial, and the crucial witness comes off very well for the defense and not so well for prosecutors.
The teen also made some inconsistent statements, but then so have people in the Jackson camp. Last week, when the singer was a no-show in court, one of his lawyers blamed a fall.
He tripped this morning and he fell in the early morning hours while he was getting dressed. His back is in terrible pain.
On Monday, Jackson's spokeswoman seemed to blame a bad mattress.
That morning when he awakened, he couldn't even walk or move his back.
But as he left court, Jackson seemed better and pleased.
Mesereau did a great job.
Vince Gonzalez, CBS News, Santa Maria, California.
The Michael Jackson trial appears to be taking a toll not just on the pop star, but also his legal team. One of his lawyers fell ill in court yesterday. Jennifer Miller reports.
As the prosecution builds its case against Michael Jackson, the pop star seems to be feeling a bit better.
walking slowly into the courthouse, but with confidence. It was another story for one of his lawyers, Brian Oxman, who became ill just as court ended for the day and had to be carried out on a gurney.
He doesn't feel too well. He's being evaluated.
This morning, detectives gave more testimony about the police raid on Jackson's home in November of 2003. And again, the jury saw more evidence, books and adult magazines seized from the pop star's home. Prosecutors say Jackson used the material to entice the accuser.
That he showed this type of pornography of young girls to the boys to get them interested and for them to acquiesce to molestation with him. But it's kind of a few quantum leaps there, I think, for a jury.
Some 69 sheriff's deputies took part in the raid at Neverland Ranch. The prosecution is trying to show they were thorough, but Jackson's defense argues they were overzealous and botched evidence.
Some of the material was mislabeled and placed in bags before being tested for fingerprints. Prosecutors still hope the judge will allow jurors to hear evidence from allegations made against Jackson in 1993. They plan to argue that case in court next Monday, but they must first convince the judge that the current allegations are credible. Jennifer Miller, CBS News, Santa Maria, California.
We're nearly a week into spring, but a storm moving up.
The defense in the Michael Jackson trial suffered a big setback today. The judge said he will allow the prosecution to present evidence that Jackson has been accused of molesting children before and that he paid to settle two of the cases. Vince Gonzalez is covering the trial for us in Santa Maria, California.
The case against Michael Jackson seemed to be going his way, but now the singer's past is about to catch up with him. In a clear victory for DA Tom Snedden, the judge ruled that under California law, jurors could hear about old, unproven molestation allegations involving five boys because they may show Jackson has a history of abuse.
This is now a trial about pattern evidence, about propensity, and once a pedophile, always a pedophile, and things will never be the same.
Only one alleged victim, the son of a former Neverland housekeeper, will actually testify. Four others, including a famous former child actor, have denied they were molested or have refused to appear. Instead, new witnesses will say they saw Jackson kissing, hugging, and fondling these four boys.
It's one thing to say that one family is out to get Michael Jackson. Now they have to come into court and say that many families are, and they all have the same story, and they're all in it for money. And that's a tough sell with the jury.
But one of these new witnesses, a longtime Jackson associate, tells CBS News he will categorically deny the allegations prosecutors say he's made. And the defense points out some of the new witnesses lost a civil suit against Jackson and sold stories to the tabloids. So did the only old accuser who will testify. His family and this boy's settled with the singer for cash. This boy's settlement frustrated a criminal investigation by D.A. Snedden, so the state passed what some call the Michael Jackson Law, the same law Snedden used to get the old allegations into this case. CBS News has learned because of the judge's ruling, the defense may now change its strategy.
Is Jackson angry enough to give up the safety of staying behind the defense table and maybe testifying?
We understand that Michael is angry enough to now take the stand on his defense. He feels it's the only way he'll be able to clear his name.
Jackson's team has promised to attack every new allegation and each new witness that comes up, basically conducting a series of mini trials within the trial. And Bob, that could add months to this case.
Okay, thank you very much, Vince. We want to turn now to the case of Terry Shively.
And Yardley, thanks. In the Michael Jackson trial, emotional testimony from a young man who claims Jackson molested him more than a decade ago. CBS News correspondent Vince Gonzalez reports.
A long-planned candlelight vigil and show of fan support for Michael Jackson coincided with one of the worst days yet for the singer. The self-proclaimed king of pop arrived at the court to a shower of rose petals and walked in looking confident. But inside, a 24-year-old car parts salesman and youth mentor, whose mother was Jackson's maid at Neverland Ranch, told jurors the singer molested him three times when he was approximately 7, 8, and 10 years old. Twice at a Jackson-owned condo in Los Angeles the young man called the Hideout, and one last time at Neverland. He said each incident started with Jackson tickling him, and that led to fondling. After each of the first two incidents, the accuser claims the singer put a $100 bill down his pants. He described his testimony as, quote, so much harder than I thought, and cried at one point.
To break down in tears as he recalled these incidents from 14 years ago, I think gives a real poignancy to it and a real power to it.
The young man is the first person to testify about a series of old, unproven allegations that California law allows prosecutors to introduce. He's the only alleged victim who will take the stand.
This was very, very powerful, extremely damaging.
But lead defense attorney Tom Mesereau called the alleged abuse improper tickling and pointed out the young man initially denied Jackson ever touched him. The young man said he was embarrassed and didn't want to tell anyone what had happened. For his part, Jackson returned home to more adoring fans and flowers. He'll be back in court today as the young man continues his testimony. Vince Gonzalez, CBS News, Santa Maria, California.
And in sports, the NCAA basketball championship was a classic.
Welcome back. There was more graphic testimony in the Michael Jackson trial this week. Friday, another former employee took the stand, claiming to have seen the pop star abusing a famous child actor. CBS News correspondent Vince Gonzalez reports.
Another day, another former Neverland employee testifies he saw Michael Jackson inappropriately touch a child. Former Jackson cook Philippe Lamarck told jurors he once saw the singer with his hand in the pants of child actor Macaulay Culkin, which Culkin has denied. Former Neverland maid Adrian McManus has claimed she watched the singer kiss and fondle Culkin and other boys. But is their testimony having an impact?
Going into this, you know, there was a lot of smoke out there about him. Now we're hearing the fire. You know, where there's smoke, there's fire.
But CBS News consultant and Jackson biographer J. Randy Taraborelli says the defense is attacking the witness's credibility and could be scoring points with the jury.
Basically, what we're getting are a lot of tabloid informants going before the jury, and then we're getting Michael Jackson's attorney practically butchering them on the witness stand. I mean, it's a bloodbath in there.
McManus on Friday admitted lying under oath, suing Jackson, and using a media broker to sell stories to the tabloids.
I don't think the jury believed much of what this woman had to say.
As for Lamarck, the defense has pointed out he has changed his story, saying in the past Jackson's hand was outside Culkin's pants. Jurors weren't allowed to hear about his pornographic website, which Lamarck reportedly called the most sinful on the internet. Whether the testimony about old unproven allegations allowed under California law is helping the prosecution or not, DA Tom Sneddon told the judge there was a light at the end of the tunnel, and he's getting closer to wrapping up his case against Michael Jackson. Vince Gonzalez, CBS News, Los Angeles.
And with more on how the trial is going and what the jury might make of the testimony.
He's in life with two criminologists. In the Michael Jackson trial today, the accuser's mother could take the stand again. On Monday, the mother of Jackson's 1993 accuser testified that Jackson gave her expensive gifts while he spent nights alone with her son. CBS News correspondent Vince Gonzalez reports.
Michael Jackson owns mansions, estates, and even apartments. But this woman, the mother of Jackson's 1993 accuser, says the singer stayed overnight at her house more than 30 times in her son's room where there was only one bed. Her son, who was paid millions by Jackson to settle a lawsuit, hasn't spoken to her in 11 years. Perhaps because, as she testified, she took tens of thousands of dollars in jewelry and shopping sprees from Jackson while the singer spent nights alone with her son. CBS News consultant J. Randy Taraborelli first spoke to her back in 1993.
She really seemed to be living a great life experience, and she seemed to be very happy. Now she seems as if all of the life force has been drained from her.
She never said she saw the singer abuse a child, but when she did express concern once, she claims a crying Jackson begged her to trust him.
Basically, she was a very sad person to listen to, but I thought on balance very credible.
But the prosecution stumbled with the next witness. Former Neverland employee Dwayne Swingler was supposed to bolster the current conspiracy charge. Prosecutors seemed surprised when he also admitted trying to sell a book, saying, quote, I wanted to cash in like everybody else was.
If that's the prosecution's case for conspiracy.
Swingler is just the latest in a string of witnesses who tried to cash in, sought money from Jackson, or were shown to have a financial incentive to lie. Not good news for the prosecution case. Vince Gonzalez, CBS News, Santa Maria, California.
Martha Stewart is staying put for now. On Monday, Stewart asked.
You'd think this person walking into the courtroom with a hood over her face might be the defendant. But he walks in to cheers from fans, although they've dwindled to just a handful. No, this is one of the key witnesses for the prosecution in the Michael Jackson trial, the mother of the boy accusing Jackson. and she has given the legal pundits something to talk about.
Scattered, who was strange, and at times really bizarre.
I think today we went from Neverland to Fantasyland.
The more she talks, the worse it gets for the prosecution.
Before she even took the stand last week, the mother refused to testify about allegations she's a welfare cheat. The judge was forced to tell jurors she's been accused of theft and perjury. Then the real theatrics began. On her first day on the stand, she cried, begged for the jury's forgiveness, and gave a rambling account of her family being held against its will. Over the next few days, she calmed some, but still had outbursts, telling the jury Jackson's people convinced her the killers were after her family, and that she thinks, quote, every time there's a knock at the door, it's either a subpoena or a killer. Sources tell CBS News Jackson called her the best defense witness yet. But will the jury buy it? Defense attorney Michael Cardoza is watching the case.
Even paranoid schizophrenics are correct at times.
It's been a rocky road for prosecutors since day one of this trial, beginning with DA Tom Snedden's confusing opening statements. Then there was the shaky testimony of the accuser and his siblings. Other prosecution witnesses actually helped the defense refute charges of conspiracy and giving alcohol to minors. And the physical evidence is just one set of fingerprints from Jackson and the accuser found in one pornographic magazine. The judge handed prosecutors one key victory, allowing them to bring in witnesses who told old unproven stories that had been whispered about for years, that Jackson had abused other little boys. Including one young man who said Jackson abused him, and the mother of a boy who was paid more than $20 million by Jackson in 1994. Ann Bremner is a lawyer who comes to watch the proceedings often.
Do you think this strategy worked for the prosecution, bringing in these old allegations?
Absolutely. Pattern evidence, once a pedophile, always a pedophile. Very, very powerful evidence, and it worked.
But defense attorney Tom Mesereau showed that some of the other witnesses, mostly former Jackson employees, had a financial incentive to lie, had sued Jackson unsuccessfully, or had a possible motive for revenge. The key question is, what might the jury think as the prosecution prepares to wrap up its case?
Has the prosecution proved its case? Has it hit every mark?
On the molestation, I think that a jury would be justified in finding him guilty right now.
Legal analyst Jim Murray sees it a little differently.
You still have to prove the underlying case. Have they proved it? Have they proved a molestation? I would argue no. But we haven't heard the whole case yet.
The accuser's mother isn't the only one who's exhibited strange behavior as this trial has unwound. We've seen the defendant show up one day in his pajamas. And there are at least two more months of this, and maybe as many as four.
Why?
Still, sources close to Jackson tell CBS News the singer is so convinced right now he'll be acquitted, he's planning a triumphant world tour with his brothers. But prosecutors and prison officials are already planning for the singer to spend years here, Corcoran State Prison, in a special cell block with the likes of Sirhan Sirhan and Charles Manson.
Or what caused the fire. Now to the Michael Jackson trial. Prosecutors want to call a former security guard at Jackson's estate as their final witness. CBS News correspondent Vince Gonzalez is live in Santa Maria, California, with details. Good morning, Vince.
Good morning, Julie. Perhaps hoping to end with a bombshell rather than a whimper, the prosecution made a last-minute appeal to the judge to allow more old, unproven allegations that Jackson abused other boys.
The prosecution wants this former security guard, Kasim Abdul, to repeat his claim that he was asked to bring an item to Jackson's bedroom where he found Jackson and a boy he believes later became the singer's 1993 accuser. Abdul is another of a string of witnesses already called to speak about old allegations like that, and lead defense attorney Tom Mesereau has mounted a furious attack on the credibility of nearly every single one of them. The former guard is not a perfect witness. He once sued the singer for wrongful termination. He not only lost, but had to pay Jackson's legal fees. Another more recent employee testified yesterday. Brian Barron, a police officer who moonlighted as a Neverland guard for 5 years, seemed to back up the claim by the accuser's mother that they were imprisoned at the ranch.
He said someone wrote on a security office dry erase board that Michael Jackson's young accuser is not allowed off property. A similar security log entry read, "The kids are not to leave per Joe, a ranch manager," kids meaning the accuser and his brother. But Barron said he never saw anything unlawful at the ranch, and the policy was not to let children leave without adult supervision. At that time, he said, the accuser's mother was not at Neverland. His reading of ranch records also seemed to contradict the mother's testimony about where and when key events occurred.
And the issue that that's raising is the timeline. And if the mother is wrong or confused as to the timeline, question one, is she lying? Question two, is she mistaken?
A source close to the case tells CBS News she is not mistaken, and other records support her timeline. Her 5 days on the stand focus mainly on Jackson Associates, not the singer himself. In fact, she had only one conversation with him over 3 years.
Basically, she spent more time on the witness stand than she ever spent in Michael Jackson's company. And according to our sources, Michael Jackson's question after hearing her testimony was, what does any of that have to do with me?
Now, if the judge allows that other former worker to testify, he could be among the last of the prosecution witnesses. The district attorney says he hopes to wrap up his case next week. Julie.
CBS's Vince Gonzalez in Santa Maria. Thanks, Vince. This morning, there are growing worries in Iraq.
It may make it impossible for him to keep a pledge to serve a full third term as prime minister. Renee.
CBS's Richard Roth in London. Thanks. Well, as we noted, the defense at Michael Jackson's trial began with two young men who testified that he never abused them. CBS News correspondent Vince Gonzalez reports.
The first witness for Michael Jackson's defense, star choreographer Wade Robson, told jurors he first met Jackson at age 5 and shared a bed with him more than 20 times until he was 14. Two former Neverland employees told prosecutors Jackson groped Robson and took a shower with him. Robson, who once had a show on MTV, denied either of those things happened. Lead defense attorney Tom Mesereau asked, "Did Michael Jackson molest you at any time?" Robson responded, "Absolutely not." The second defense witness, Brett Barnes, said the same thing, adding, "I can tell you that if he had, I wouldn't be here." Barnes said he shared Jackson's bed until he was 19.
Even if you assume what they say is true, it's still unsettling to think. I think that many of the jurors looked at Michael Jackson and thought, I wonder.
And something strange happened in court. Prosecutors who'd called Robson and Barnes victims of sex crimes attacked them with sharp, very personal questions. Jurors seemed riveted as Robson was forced to describe photos of naked boys and read a series of graphic porn titles seized from Jackson's home. That treatment may be a signal to other Jackson friends who might testify.
You know, Macaulay Culkin has been waffling back and forth on deciding whether to testify for a number of weeks now. And I would think that after he hears about Wade Robson's experience with the prosecutors, he might actually think twice about it. It was that ugly.
Robson seemed angry as he left court. His mother and sister will likely testify today. Vince Gonzalez, CBS News, Santa Maria, California.
The runaway bride says she's sorry. Jennifer Wilbank's three-day vanishing act sparked an intense...
In the Michael Jackson trial, a key prosecution witness is expected to testify today, Jackson's ex-wife. CBS News correspondent Vince Gonzalez is live in Santa Maria, California with the latest on this much-anticipated testimony. Good morning, Vince.
Good morning, Hannah. Michael Jackson's ex-wife, CBS News, has been told expects she will be called to the stand today. What's still not clear is how deeply prosecutors will be able to delve into Jackson's private life when they question her. One thing prosecutors will be sure to ask, were pro-Jackson statements like this scripted?
And he is such a fabulous man.
The mother of Jackson's accuser says they were. Roe will likely be questioned about her appearance in this so-called rebuttal program that aired on Fox. Prosecutors may also try to find out about Jackson's sexuality and his private life with Roe, who had two children with the singer.
She doesn't hold the key to Michael Jackson's jail cell, but I think she will hold the key to the jury's attention.
The defense will surely point out Roe is locked in a custody battle with Jackson over their children and is reportedly upset because the singer has not paid alimony for more than a year.
The line of contention which the defense has long maintained is that there has been a quest for money, and Debbie Roe is no different.
Yesterday, jurors heard from two witnesses who seemed to back up the accuser's mother's claims of conspiracies, false imprisonment, and an attempt to take her family to Brazil. But the defense showed video producer Hamid Moslehi and travel agent Cynthia Montgomery are both suing Jackson. The singer is suing her over an incident in which he was secretly videotaped on this flight she arranged. Jurors learned she received immunity for her testimony because she faces possible prosecution.
If Debbie Rowe does testify today, the question is, who's up next? She was expected to be the big finale for the prosecution, but we know they have other witnesses and issues they may want to go into before they wrap up their case. Hannah?
CBS's Vince Gonzalez in Santa Maria, thank you. Police in Elgin, Illinois, that's near Chicago.
She was never afraid. Jurors in the Michael Jackson trial will not be hearing from talk show host Larry King. On Thursday, King showed up for court, but the judge ruled he could not testify because his statements were irrelevant. The defense did call a friend of the accuser's family. She testified. The family never complained about Jackson.
The Michael Jackson child molestation trial will go to the jury tomorrow. Jackson and members of his family were back in court in Santa Maria, California today to hear both sides present their closing arguments. Prosecutors said Jackson targeted vulnerable young boys. The defense called his accuser's family, quote, con artists. CBS News spent a week with Jackson's most ardent supporters at the courthouse, and no matter what the verdict, they will always be there for their idol, as Vince Gonzalez reports in tonight's Inside Story.
While Michael Jackson has been fighting for his life inside a California courtroom, for months, a different sort of drama has been playing out outside the courthouse.
Everybody will get one ticket, and then we will do the lotto draw.
Every morning before dawn,
I waited so long for this day.
A small group of diehard fans gathers outside the Santa Maria courthouse,
856,
hoping to win a lottery for one of the few seats in the courtroom.
You do not yell and scream for Michael Jackson. If you do, you are out of the courtroom.
Some have put their lives on hold for a man prosecutors say is a child molester.
Michael is a part of my childhood. He will always be a part of me.
Doobie Redburn came from Los Angeles with her son, Tony. She says he was born with cerebral palsy and claims only when he heard Jackson's music did he begin to move his legs.
She would put on the Thriller album and I would kick and my legs and arms would be in the beat of the music. Today I'm doing fine and I'm moonwalking.
Not everyone can claim that kind of MJ miracle. But some Jackson fans do describe their passion as a moral duty.
Michael Jackson fans truly are warriors. I have said that because to be a fan today is hard. Like he's saying, he's in a battle.
Put it up loud, please.
Maggie DeFiera left her nursing job in San Diego to spend a week in Santa Maria. She's 59 and has two kids.
I had bone marrow cancer. I was on the deathbed. And I'm not saying that he healed me. No, I healed me, but he's soothing.
She's followed the trial closely, but long ago reached her own verdict.
I know he's not guilty of anything.
Despite the chance their hero may go to jail, true believers are still dancing, even getting together to spend thousands on Jackson memorabilia.
I got Michael's hat.
And their devotion is rewarded when Michael Jackson calls.
I really believe I have the most amazing fans in the whole world.
On a really good day last April, Jackson invited his fans into Neverland, no cameras allowed.
I cannot believe it!
But none were really needed, because for these Jackson fans,
I-N-N-O-C-E-N-N-O-C-E-N.
The memories will last longer than any scandal. Vince Gonzalez, CBS News, Santa Maria, California.
On the other side of the country, Jennifer Wilbanks, the 32-year-old Georgia woman dubbed the runaway bride.
CBS Evening News with Bob Schieffer.
And Bob is off tonight. Michael Jackson has a most unusual lifestyle. He admits to sleeping with children, but is the 46-year-old pop star a child molester? It is now up to a jury in Santa Maria, California, to answer that question. After hearing 3 months of testimony from 135 witnesses, a panel of 8 women and 4 men began their deliberations today. Vince Gonzalez has been following the trial from day one.
Michael Jackson walked into the Santa Maria courthouse for closing arguments on day 66 of his trial, days that have taken a toll on the singer. Gone are the stunts and confident strides seen at the beginning of this case. Over the months, the singer's become a haggard and grim figure prone to illness. Just yesterday, a dehydrated Jackson stopped at a hospital after court for intravenous fluids. In the courtroom, attorneys from both sides told the jury what facts they believe are key to proving Jackson's guilt or innocence. Lead defense attorney Tom Mesro made an impassioned argument, going through detailed testimony of the accuser and his family, pointing out inconsistencies and instances where they admitted lying. He called them con artists, actors, and liars. Mesro read jurors the specific law and instructions on reasonable doubt, telling them dramatically, "You must, under this standard, throw this case where it belongs, out the door. Michael Jackson goes home where he belongs." It reminded observers of another famous moment in a celebrity trial.
I almost expected him to come up with a slogan, "If there's reasonable doubt, you must throw it out."
Prosecutor Ron Zonin tore into Jackson and tried to defend a sprawling, complicated case by bringing it back to the singer's accuser, the alleged victim in this case. Zonin asked jurors to believe the teen and find Jackson guilty on all counts, saying, "The accusations are not false, they are entirely accurate and entirely trustworthy."
Usually prosecutors like clarity in closing arguments, and it's the defense that likes to confuse the jury. The opposite occurred here during these closing arguments. It was the defense that was more specific, and I think that bodes well for Jackson.
Add that to an already troubled prosecution case. Numerous witnesses admitted lying or seeking money. Others turned on the DA on the stand and became great defense witnesses. But the defense had to explain why Michael Jackson sleeps in the same bed as children to a jury of citizens who live far from Hollywood.
This is not a place that's terribly accepting of diversity or people who have different lifestyles.
12 of those citizens are now deciding Jackson's fate. They got the case this afternoon, then they went home for the weekend, and they'll begin deliberating again Monday morning. John?
Vince, since we can only guess, what's the betting on how long this is going to take for a verdict?
No one really knows for sure. There are 10 counts, but this jury's been wrestling with them for 14 weeks. I think they know this case pretty well. Among the press corps here is the thought that perhaps midweek we could get a verdict, but only the jury knows for sure.
All right. Vince Gonzalez tonight in Santa Maria, California. Vince, thanks very much. We got a reminder today of just how important special report.
Good day, John Roberts reporting from CBS News headquarters in New York. There is breaking news from California at this hour in the Michael Jackson child molestation trial. On its seventh day of deliberation, the Associated Press is quoting sheriff's deputies as saying that the jury in Santa Maria, California has sent word that it has reached a verdict. That would be after some 31 hours of deliberations over the course of 7 days. It will be a while, though, before we know what that verdict is and what then lies in store for the eccentric pop star Michael Jackson. It will take some time. Judge Melville has given the parties an hour to get to the courtroom, at least an hour or more for the parties to return to hear the verdict being read. There are no cameras that are allowed inside, but CBS News does have a team at the courthouse headed up by correspondent Vince Gonzalez. And we also believe that there will be an audio feed of the verdict. So as soon as they start to read that verdict, we will bring it to you live. The 46-year-old Jackson is accused of molesting a young boy at his Neverland Ranch back in 2003, either February or March of that year. The charges break down this way. Jackson faces 4 counts of committing a lewd act on the boy, 1 count of attempting such an act, 4 counts of giving alcohol to the boy, who was then 13 years old, and 1 count of conspiring to commit child abduction, extortion, and false imprisonment. Now, Vince Gonzalez is at the courtroom or outside the Santa Maria County Courthouse right now. And Vince, what can you tell us about this word that a verdict has been reached by the jury in this trial?
It actually came as a little bit of a surprise to us, John. There had just been a statement released by the court saying that jurors had asked for a readback of some testimony, that there had been some meetings with attorneys on Friday, and that they'd had another question this morning. But then as the attorneys were gathering, the jury withdrew the question. And we thought we were in for another long day, perhaps more days of waiting for a verdict in this case, when suddenly the word came out there is indeed a verdict and Michael Jackson has been called to the courthouse.
Now, Vince, what about these meetings over the course of the past week? We had heard during the week, last week, that there was one request for a readback of some testimony, but now we hear that one attorney representing a media outlet has gone to court now, saying that there have been a number of meetings between the judge and the parties involved, and there were numerous readbacks of testimony before the jury. How much are you learning about that?
Well, this was the problem with no verdict and no information from the court. Just rumor and speculation was filling the verdict void. So what we had were these unconfirmed reports that there had been numerous readbacks, some of them perhaps the accuser's testimony, that there had been questions going to the attorney. So a lawyer representing the media pool here went to court, filed a brief telling the judge, please tell us what's going on. This is rumor we're hearing. Please confirm or deny this. We then got the statement from the court saying on Friday there was one readback, that there had been meetings with the attorneys, perhaps to consider jurors' questions, and that today there had been that one juror question. It's been more than a week now of deliberations here, and everyone has been trying to figure out what's been going on in that deliberation room. The questions have come to us daily. What's happening? When will there be a verdict? And that just seemed to be something we were going to have to wait to hear from the jury, and now it appears we finally will, and this issue of secrecy will no longer be an issue here.
Vince Gonzalez outside the courthouse in Santa Maria, California. We also have on hand our CBS News legal consultant, Andrew Cohen. And Andrew, what do you make of the length of time that the jury took in coming to a verdict? It's been said typically that the longer a jury is out, the worse it may play for the defendant. But in this case, I mean, we have almost 100 pages of instructions from Judge Melville to the jury, and as well all of that testimony that they have to go over. So how would you read the length of time that the jury took?
Well, John, about 32 hours of deliberations, give or take a half an hour or so. I mean, I think the big news now that we suspect or we know that this verdict is coming is there was this readback of testimony on Friday. We know it happened. The judge confirmed it just about an hour ago. We don't know whose testimony was read back, but clearly that broke whatever deadlock was going on inside that room that took place last week. Clearly, that testimony read back to the jury inside the jury room changed somebody's mind and led to the verdict that we're about to hear. And that's the way it works. Somebody has a problem, somebody remembers testimony one way and then doesn't the next way. And so you have this testimony read back. That's obviously the sort of the game changer here and why we're on the verdict watch. Now, as far as the 30 hours goes, a standard in this kind of a case.
All right. Andrew Cohen outside the courthouse, thanks very much. We're going to go off the air now for just a few minutes. We will be back on, though, shortly. The judge has told us that the verdict is going to be read at 4:30 Eastern time. That would be 1:30 Pacific time. He has given all the parties in the case, again, an hour to get to the courthouse. The word went out about 10 minutes ago, so they should be in court in about 48 minutes or so. We'll be back on the air well before that to bring you all of the goings-on there in Santa Maria, in Santa Barbara County. We should point out, by the way, Jackson facing 10 counts in this case. If the jury convicts him on all counts, he could be facing 18 years in prison. Again, we'll be back on the air shortly, but until then, we return you now to your regularly scheduled programming. John Roberts at CBS News in New York. We'll be back soon. Stay with us.
For news 24 hours a day, log on to cbsnews.com.